I'm Luke Naylor, Wildlife Management Division Chief for the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. So we're up here and we have a very major project we heard a little about just a minute ago about Black River, Dave Donaldson, Black River WMA, which is one of the massive, in the grand scheme of public lands, one of the very large, highly valuable, they're all valuable, but this is one of those massive places that's a really special little island, as you can see on the map on the left, that indicates all the forested landscape left in the Delta of Arkansas. And we're very proud as a public land management agency to be able to point at it from this scale and say those green blobs, a lot of that has to do with the public land base in this state, both state and federal ownership. And we can't talk about that without mentioning that, of course, there's lots of privately held and managed forested lands as well, but a whole ton of that's on public land, including that big blob farthest to the north up there. So I'm going to set a little context for why we do what we do at Black River and all of our forested wetland, bottom and hardwood forest, wetland WMAs. So we focus on ducks all the time, and I'll talk about ducks, and that is a phenomenal tie you have on, sir. But we have lots of other species. As a wildlife management agency, we have a mandate to manage for many, many different species, not just the green-headed yellow-billed monster of the marsh, which we all know and love, but we manage for all these different critters. And these big patches we have really are, when we do conservation planning for other species, you look at maps like this for these other species that are a little bit harder to detect. You may hear them a bunch, but you may not see them very often. These public land blocks really anchor these patches for these other critters out there. So I just want to focus on that. The second thing about the mallard itself, right? When we talk about forested wetlands, forests in general, green tree reservoirs, we've got to think back that not every tree is created equal when it comes to all of them have their place in the landscape. There's no good tree or bad tree on the landscape necessarily, but different species have different values for different types of wildlife, and we think of waterfowl, we focus most of our efforts and our interest on red oak species and perpetuating those species in bottom and hardwood forests because of their food value to waterfowl. And several years ago now, it's time flies, but this commission supported staff in a major way many years ago, 6 years ago about now, to kind of shift and, well, really formalize and shift what we do with bottom and hardwood forest management and GTRs. We actually put in writing, really about for the first time in the agency's history at a large scale, we said, this is what we value. These are our objectives in green tree reservoir management. And it's about long-term sustainable habitats. We shifted our focus that had always been focused on annual provision, oftentimes focused on waterfowl hunting opportunity, which is a very valuable objective to have, and that is still one of our objectives, but we shifted it to a long-term vision instead of an annual, we're going to do this every year, with less focus on the long-term and what it means for habitat and hunting opportunity.
Hey, Luke.
Yes, sir.
Are we doing this three-year rotational cycle? I know we put this out in print as a notional idea, but are we doing this anywhere?
This is an example. This is a theoretical concept of what a naturally functioning bottom and hardwood system would look like. And so it's not a prescriptive figure. It is in a natural system, spikes and valleys and peaks. That's how these river systems, bios, they all function historically before lots of landscape change and infrastructure was installed. Just an example. Yes, moving forward, with some of the changes we talk about for all of our WMAs, the gentleman talked about Shirey Bay and some work going on there. This kind of stuff is going to be part of our future with new management and new infrastructure. All right, I'm going to hit quickly the forested landscape at Black River. Rob Willey and his team, Tucker Collins is sitting here, who's been the Northeast Arkansas habitat biologist, forester, and has led a bunch of this work to carry on our forest health assessments, really their forest inventory overall, which also includes a forest health assessment, which we are the only state, only landowner in the country that's doing this type of work on forested landscapes. So not going to read through all those bullets. Just the indication is, yes, like all of our managed bottom and hardwood systems, we have concerns about red oak forest health. We know at Black River, there was a major change in red oak forest health 20 plus years ago. Not going to go into all that, but the existing forest has challenges. It's not a dramatic, like, boy, we're worried about things dying tomorrow, like we presented to y'all about Henry Gray Hurricane Lake in some places. Every situation is different, and this one is cause for concern and cause for to focus on long-term sustainability, but there's not imminent death on hand at Black River, it doesn't seem. So, and I'm confident Rob and Tucker will wave at me and stop me if I say something wrong. I'm gonna pause right there. All the people involved in this, you met a bunch of the Northeast Arkansas Wildlife Management Division staff yesterday on our field trip. I am the spokesperson for all this stuff. Was as a waterfowl biologist for a while and now as a chief. I'm not the brains behind this stuff. So we've got the forested side with Rob leading the charge. We've got Jason Jackson in the back, he goes by Buck. He's our redneck hydrologist and everything, moving water and making things good happen for infrastructure. We've got Zach Yancey, who's a local biologist and manager at Black River, and Jason Carball, who's a regional supervisor in this area. Terrence Teal, who's Jason's the assistant. Terrence, the regional supervisor for this area. Who else? Even Mike Cantrell in operations helps us out with this stuff. So lots of people involved. Am I missing something somewhere? Anyway. All these folks helped build this, and Duggar, before he jumped ship, he was the assistant chief in wildlife, involved in a lot of our GTR work. Okay, so location. I pointed out on a map, I'm going to go through a couple of these, the very large area, phenomenal place. Those yellow polygons are the green tree reservoirs that are impounded, levied up systems to have some sort of infrastructure in them, in this massive forested landscape, with that blue line being the Black River proper running through. So this is a LIDAR map, so just a digital elevation model showing elevation. So there's a lot of fall through this system. But if you really get down to the middle of it, it's a couple dozen feet maybe, not 100 feet of fall through these areas. These are flat areas that pond water quickly, that water moves through and oftentimes doesn't want to move out of. And that presents a lot of the challenges we have now. So that's what it looks like elevation-wise. You see everything coming out of Northeast Arkansas and Southeast Missouri and plowing down through the Black River before it heads in toward Pocahontas after meeting up with the current. So this is our infrastructure as of now. There's a lot of it. There's a lot of stuff going on out there, and you've got all the yellow boxes are structures to the tune of 37 of them to manage 7,000 acres of impounded water. And all the orange lines are some sort of levee in the system. So elevation above natural grade. What would have been historic through this ridge and swale slough system, we levied it up with all these levees. And these little things are an interesting creation that maybe not totally unique to Black River, but it's maybe there's in highest abundance at Black River, which we call slough plugs. So when water comes in, these sloughs connect to the Black River, and many of these are plugs put in to keep water from flowing back out into the Black River once these things are artificially flooded. 26 miles of levee. This is a real quick schematic of kind of how the water happens now, right? So Little River Dam up here where the river splits, plug that up and immediately you have water flowing in, depending on water levels in the Little River, of course, but immediately have water come in, it cascades here, could cascade to the lower island, GTR. These are called siphons, they aren't true siphons, they're pipes under the river. They're none less cool because they're not actually siphons. It's a fascinating engineering feat that Dave Donaldson, as a gentleman mentioned earlier, that this guy created many years ago. He went under the river twice, goes into Upper Reno, goes through here, builds up head, can go into Lower Reno, depending on how Zach's operating the structures, goes in lower siphons, then goes into the Winchester GTR. This is Lake Ashball, and this is a rest area that's forested, part of Winchester GTR, just north of Lake Ashball. You could call this section toward the lower Winchester GTR, if you will, and this is how water flows through the system. And then ideally, it's going to come out down here as easily as it comes in up here. Fact is, that's not how it works. It gets plugged up. So when we look, we're working with Ducks Unlimited. Tim Willis is in the room right here, who's a Northeast Arkansas native, by the way. Just happens to work for Ducks Unlimited out of Ridgeland, Mississippi now. And they're working with some engineers and hydraulic modelers who have built maps like this. So this is just a real quick schematic. If you look during a flood event and how water should flow through an area, a naturally functioning system, you should have what we call sheet flow. It just moves through the area, it goes across, it doesn't make these funny twists and turns. You think, look at things like this, where there's a levee spur in Winchester. We have a look, just, that's just one example of an area where water has to go up and around man-made infrastructure. It's similar here, right? We're trying to send all this water that would have sheet flowed out, come in up here, Black River, and sheet flowed all the way across and connected back to the Black River and gone out. It is all stopped. And you see all of it has to go up and around here and kind of, it's kind of got to weave its way around to get out here through this pinch point. And that is a classic story within managed bottom and hardwood forest or green tree reservoirs. That's what we're trying to manage within and do better moving forward. So you can't read that. That's not the point. The point is these are all the different scenarios that we said, sent back to the modelers and said, hey, do this, do this, do that, like fix these structures, change these levees, run all this through your models and tell us what the outcome is. That's a lot of work. The top, so the, in almost all these situations, the best, if we were purely to think only about forest ecology and duck ecology, we would have zero artificial infrastructure across any of our land holdings. That's really, if you were going to go pure, just ecological function, that's what you do. So that's where we start. We say, okay, remove everything. What's that do? This down here is an increased downstream flow, which that was a trigger point for our engineers who worry about downstream flow and what it means to downstream communities. So remove everything, a fairly large predicted, these are all predictions, let me be very clear about that. They're predictive increases in flow downstream. All right, so we walk all the way through all this stuff, we come up with a preferred scenario that I'm gonna walk through a little bit down at the bottom that has 28 structures modified, 13 miles of levee impacted, 1,000 acres of artificial, I'll be very clear, artificial inundation flooding reduced, about a half a foot depth reduction, which is a positive thing for foraging ducks and the total amount of acre feet of water you're holding in a complex when it's time to move it out. Downstream flow, total inundation area reduced, smaller storm event right here is these three columns. In a large storm event, the impact is a little bit lower. And the amount of acres reduced, because you'll see as we run through the model scenarios here in a second, the Black River rule is all up there. And frankly, a fair bit of our infrastructure is not that much additive when it comes to water on the landscape during the winter.
Hey, Luke.
Yes, sir.
Before you get into the first scenario, it's oftentimes easy for the public to assume that no work is getting done because there's no yellow equipment out in the wildlife management area. Can you tell us how much time and how much money in partnership with Ducks Unlimited it's taken us just to get to this point where we can apply for permitting in January?
We started with DU and NSAFE. Well, we started with a different hydrologic contractor for a period of time back in 2020, I believe, and then moved on. Worked with DU and NSAFE the last 2 years, Buck, Tim? About two full years, Austin, where we've been working on this behind the scenes. There's a lot of survey work that needed to be done. Most of our WMAs, you might think we have good survey information, we know everything about the landscape and all of our WMAs. We don't. These guys like Dave Donaldson, who built this stuff, we're just eyeballing it, which is pretty fascinating, but we don't have survey information, so that was a ton of time there to just collect that information necessary to run these models. We're doing this on our massive WMAs. We're in the same process at Biometa right now because there's so much going on here that we have called in outside assistance to help us understand what's going on. We're very confident in our ability to manage these systems, but it's always nice to check that for a second and just double check the numbers and have a little outside help on some things. So, all right, so if you were to define a kind of a new objective for Dave Donaldson and what the preferred scenario allow us to do, It really seeks to bring Donaldson closer to natural conditions and again focus on sustainable bottom and hardwood forests. And we still want to maintain that ability to provide managed hunting opportunity. Although that managed hunting opportunity, like across all of our GTRs, is going to look different than it has in the past. First sub-bullet there, it's a lot of our infrastructure is largely irrelevant. I may sound like I'm contradicting myself in a second. It doesn't add more flooded area on the landscape when the river's up. What it does do is keep things from draining as quickly as they need to when the river goes down. Those are two different considerations, and both are important. All right, so what are they? And not going to read through all of those. Those are the items that were on when we first went and said, all right, NSAFE, our H&H hydrologic and hydraulic engineering contractor, here are the items that we would do as part of the preferred scenario. All right, run it through your model. This is the whole list of them. All right, so that's what we asked them to do in the preferred scenario. And I'm going to come back to this as we went through the model results and we had our folks looking at it. Buck's going back and forth with these folks many, many, many times, going back and forth and figuring out and talking with Zach, who's on the area every day, like, okay, what did that result in? And are we okay with that? So we modified this a bit, and I'll come back to that in a second. All right, so this is a map of the preferred scenario. All the red lines are levees that would be removed. The orangish red, however they look like to you out there. All right, so those would be levees removed in this process. I pointed out these down here as obstructions to sheep flow. Those are a couple good examples of areas that we want water to move across this area, right? And with water stacked through here, through these upper island GTRs, that's a substantial impediment to water moving across this system between the little red at Fork and the Black River itself. So all these structures, the orange structures would be removed structures. The yellow structures are upsize. When we talk about upsize, we're talking about major upsize. We're not going from a 48-inch to a 60-inch pipe. This is not the kind of project we're doing when we're fixing GTRs. We're going from 48-inch pipes to 18-foot-wide bays, like we looked at yesterday afternoon. All right, so all this stuff is removed. Upsize this channel that gets water out the very bottom, the crux of the whole thing, if you will, down here at the very bottom of the cranery structure to go out, structure number 23 on this map, go out to the Black River. That is woefully undersized and is a major pinch point like I showed earlier. Okay, so preferred scenario, what's that look like, Forrest? If you'd hit that real quick, this is gonna start playing. I'm gonna show, I think only three of these maybe, just for sake of time. So we ran these through. This is a low flow. The top is a date. So it's a little hard to see, but you watch that little blue dot bumping up through there. That is, you just passed through November 16th through November 21st. This is in a low flow at Corning Gauge. So we went back and looked at all the gauge data and kind of categorized low flow, medium flow, and high flow based on the historical record. This is 2005, 2006 as an example of one of those years. This is not predictive, prescriptive. This is an example of one year that was categorized amongst all the years as a low flow year, right? So storm comes in. This assumes a storm comes in, start, hits, floods it up, and no more rain happens, which we all know is not reality, right? So this is what Black River would look like with the changes I just showed before, after a low flow event. All right, so now that's January 10th. It's bumping along. This assumes no more rain happened, which we know, when's the last time that hasn't happened in January or late December? Not very often. The rains come, right? Typically. All right, go ahead. I'll do this. That's me. All right, a high flow event. Forrest, you would? Next one. Thank you. Same deal. So you see it kind of flatline over there for a while. You're going through November. So this is a high flow event, but the event happened a little bit later in the fall in this particular year that we grabbed, 2007, 2008. So if you're at Black River, yeah, this is not, you know, the Little River Dam is not closed, it's not forcing water into Upper Island and Lower Island and then through the siphons to Reno and on to Winchester. That's not happening, but rainfall is happening and we've implemented all the changes I showed on a previous slide. This is now mid-December. No more rain happens. This is just what sets on the landscape. We're now approaching the 1st of January. You see, again, no more rain. I can't say that enough times. The model says no more rain. All right, so it's down. Now I get a little bit of rain in mid-January. System's already a bit charged up. You get a small amount of rain and boom, here it comes right back. Now you're approaching the end of January. And you can see as it pulls on out through February in the scenario, there's another spike in rainfall. So we looked at that and it ends up in a, you can run those scenarios and the colors here are water depth. So I mentioned that earlier. So we have some, for habitat and for wildlife, we have some positive changes in overall habitat depth going down a little bit. And so the standing pool of water in these areas, say at the end of the winter, would be lower. All right. So the red, it goes up in lower Reno because you don't have the middle levee. It's actually more water stacking up in the bottom. But we're not overly concerned about that. So, all right. So what we did, as primarily Buck and Zach, we're looking at this and really thinking about how the system operates. So we've got the modeling scenario, and we've got what we see on the ground when we do stuff. So we combine those. So this is the current state of thinking about what our restoration plan for Black River would be. So it's not necessarily decommissioning the dam. Remove most slough plugs. We looked at that and we think, hey, like Zach's having to run the siphons, move water around throughout the year. There's some amount of perking that goes on, which Tommy Lake Ashball, that conversation comes up front and center. There's something going on, we think, with water, you know, falling out of that system, even though it's levied up. You know, Zach's moving water through the system because of the soil types. We're not convinced we need to move totally away from the opportunity and to do that, to provide that water through flow through the system. And the slough plugs, some of them are such a depth that you would, the assumptions of those model runs, the bottom elevation of those slough plugs is lower and would actually, some of that water would move back out. So instead of removing all of them, some of the slough plugs were actually going to install manageable infrastructure instead of just a drop. Just now it's just a plug of dirt we can't do anything with, and water just stacks up behind it. Some levees in Winchester, big upsizes in those Reno and Winchester structures. That's a big lift, and a lot of levee work, a lot of dirt work. A lot of dirt work in those two structures are the big parts of it. A lot of spillway work. I shouldn't de-emphasize that.
Luke.
Yes, sir.
On that levee, just on that, you know, I know talking to Levi and being over there, I know you're going to change some of these levees. Take
yep.
out some,
yep.
and then some will be probably added to differently. And as Levi has shown me, they have patched these levees over and over. So on these levees that you're going to have to add to, where will you get the dirt? And is it quite a bit that you're going to have to get to come in there to rebuild and to, you know, beside these levees that are there, they've dug and back a track hole now will reach down to the bottom. And some of those levees are so thin, can't even get a truck down them to repair them.
Actually, most of our levee work will be getting rid of dirt because those levees, what we've done, we looked at a little bit on BioView yesterday. So, and Buck described, you've got these levees that don't have a consistent grade, the whole length of a 4-mile levee, and water finds a way. Water always wins, like it always wins. And so it finds that low spot and it cuts through it. And what we've done, very, very frankly, as an agency, is try to beat water for years, and we've lost. Like, so we armor, we put riprap, we build it higher. What's that do? It just makes it find another weak spot. We're not doing business that way anymore. We're building levees that water can overtop entirely. We're talking about levees that are 6 inches above full surface elevation of a structure and are 10-to-1 side slopes. So water comes in, it does not have to fight anywhere. We want it to overtop the levees. by design, we're going to build levees that get overtopped every year.
So the water's not going to be as deep out in the woods. It's going to be able to go over the levees.
Over the levees.
And it's not going to be a weak spot. It's going to be that levee from one end to the other is going to be the same elevation.
Except these spillways we put in, and those will be reinforced because we're telling water, yeah, we want you to go there in some cases.
So
like at Winchester, the far west side of Winchester, right? But, so we're going to go armor some of those because there's a ton of water coming out the bottom of that one.
So for duck hunting, what depth of water are y'all trying to hopefully maintain on the majority of the woods that's out there?
Yeah, so we're not going to go in and flatten anything in the interior of these units, right? So there's going to be variation that exists now, it's still going to exist. But I mean, for a duck to feed, you're looking at a foot of water, right? But we know it's going to be deeper than that across various portions of it. The bottom end of Winchester is still going to be deeper than that, right? So you're talking 6 inches to 18 inches is what you're trying to manage for on most of these places, really. Yeah, but there's, you know, there's boat lanes people use, those sorts of things are still going to exist.
Well, but Luke, kind of like what we said 2 years ago with Bob Mita, only, you know, dropping boards to 178 and a half, that's only what we're artificially manipulating.
Correct.
And we can engineer as much as we want to, but ultimately the depth of Dave Donaldson will be determined less by us and more so what the Black River provides.
Correct. And that the last video I'll show will highlight that. But the water comes in and it's, yeah, our infrastructure is going to have it 6 to 18 inches, right? When the river comes up, it's going to overtop all of that and get, it's going to get deeper where it gets deeper, right? So just a structure example, they've gone back and forth. You looked at this yesterday, this is a six-bay structure. That would be the Kramer's, the bottom southwest corner structure at this point. It's kind of what we're looking at. How wide is that one about now? Eight?
That's pretty good. Down to, about 110
foot wide. So we looked at 15 and 18 foot structures yesterday. Okay, so here's the end of it. So pause that just a second if you would for us. Just want to do a quick setup. So we wanted to look at this and look at a preferred scenario and say, I'll let people understand a real something recent in their memory. So we picked actual Black River flows for the winter of 2021-22. And that's what this shows is if we have implemented our preferred scenario and that had been done in the winter of 21-22, this is what it would have been predicted to look like. That makes sense? So it's real world. With an artificial, we've changed the landscape. All right, thank you, Forrest. So this is through November 11th. If you can read that top one, it's tough to see, I'll kind of narrate. A little tiny bit of rain there, that's 11-16, 11-21, 11 November. Approaching the 1st of December, and the dark, if when the blue starts getting darker here in a second, to Austin's point, that's deeper. Let's get to Mr. Chairman's question. When it gets darker, that's what you're getting at. All right, so now we're right at Christmas. And you see Winchester, the Winchester GTR, the former Island GTRs, they start getting deeper up there. Now the 1st of January, January 10th. Mid-January, approaching January 20th now. And now we're at the end of January. Okay. All right, so what are we looking for as a timeline? We're kind of functionally complete with 30% engineering design plans. Our next hard target date is January 31st to have 60% plans complete and permit applications submitted simultaneously by the end of January 2024. I'm gonna jump to the next bullet. So receive permits, that's a question mark. We do not control that process. So that's late fall. Hopefully it's a 9-month process. If we get really lucky, it could be a 6-month process. If we're unlucky, it could go longer than that, which I don't want to talk about. So it's six to 12 months. So we're talking about winter of 2025, select a contractor, summer of 2025, begin construction. The last couple of years have been great construction years. Who knows what we're going to get in the future and how long it's going to take, depending on water levels. Forest management will be guided by what we get done with hydrology improvements and what the landscape will allow us to do. Any questions about that? I believe that's the last slide.
Luke, I've only had 30 months of this, but that's probably about 29 or 30 months in advance, a preview of what this public group has seen of this. I'm just so impressed with the amount of work that's gone into this and with the modifications. It appears to me you've really tried, and the team have tried, to boost up the best chance of long-term sustainable forest with giving us the maximum amount of hunter opportunity.
Yeah, it's mainly Buck and Zach, like, kind of looked at it, made some decisions, like, we're not completely comfortable just blowing out all those sleeve plugs and seeing what happens, right? But we have to be very careful that as we install infrastructure, it's going to come with a focused commitment to long-term management that is different than what it is now, right? It's still, because we have this infrastructure, doesn't mean that early flooding, guaranteed water, we don't have that at any GTR other than this, as the gentleman mentioned, right? So that's going to change, but yes, we have modified, we've looked at it. It's like, hey, we don't want the old Winchester GTR to perk all winter. We don't have an opportunity to reinforce it, right? So, yeah.
Let me follow up just real quick with a question to that. The public also, I think, needs to be aware, in your opinion, and I haven't asked you this before, but was this a flawed design by Dave Donaldson, or were we in a time where a couple of years ago we saw the water overflow I-40 for the first time in its history, and we see these flood systems taking more water than they ever have? What's your opinion?
It was not a flawed system based on the objectives of the time. It was a phenomenal system based on the objectives of the time. We just now know that long-term, predictable, it's going to flood up every year before tree dormancy, it is not sustainable. We just got so much evidence of that. It's indisputable at this point that kind of doing that stuff does not work with sustainable bottom and hardwood forests. And to your point, we're modeling all this stuff in a time of pretty wet conditions. And none of us know if 20 years from now it's going to be a drier 10 to 20 year phase. I guess the good news is that what we're building, like, if it does get dry, well, fine. We've overdone it. But if it stays wet or gets wetter, we're set for it. I'd hate to go the other direction and just plan all this during a dry time where we're thinking, yeah, it's going to be small stuff, right?
Let me add to this just a little bit, because I've leveled a bunch of ground and did surveys and levees and stuff like that. Dave Donaldson was 50 years ahead of his time. What he did was an absolute marvel that not anyone else could have touched or had the knowledge or the foresight to have seen this. He was 50 years ahead of his time. And just till 15 or 20 years ago, we would have probably come in there and done the exact same thing that he did 50 or 70 years ago. So unbelievable, but now we have a little more stuff, and here we are on down the road a little ways, and now we're doing something that's going to be really different that we think will last for maybe the next 100 years, possibly. That's a long term with what, it things have just changed, but absolute marvel what he did.
Just real, yeah, in 20 seconds, because last question, we're pressed for time, but just, how much consideration, I know you're giving a lot, just real quickly what you know, and if you just have no idea, what's the impact between 2025 and 2030 on hunter ground ability? Like, in the middle of all this construction, how much of an impact is this going to have to available hunting areas?
The river's still going to come up. and it's still going to flood the place.
Okay.
So we're going to have infrastructure out open like we've done in Hurricane.
Right. So we don't anticipate a tremendous amount of land being taken away for.
You still can't stop the river.
Right.
Right. We won't. We won't be operating infrastructure purposely holding it during the whole construction phase, but it's going to be like Hurricane's been the last few years. We're in active construction. All the structures are open, like the data you saw yesterday. When the floodwaters peaked, here came the people and they hunted.
Yeah, and that's what I think we that's what we hope for.
Yeah, exactly.
We're not going to close the wildlife management area or anything like that.
Thank you.
But we want to get the project done as soon as possible.
Yeah.
So, like, if we, you know, just using Hurricane, if we can do work on that water control structure while duck season's open because the river's letting us do it, then we're going to get it done.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I love that. I think probably the one thing we could really find a way to market better is continual, transparent communication, so that everybody kind of understands. If they know, hey, we got to get airboats in, or whatever the case is. If they know that going in, it's hard to fuss back that I went out there and this happened. Well, it's on the website. We know what's going on. Here's the progress, and I think that's all any hunter can really ask for, is just to be informed ahead of time. And I think we do a good job of that.
Like Conway, we did the website and update. Mm-hmm. Y'all going to do an updated website?
Yeah, we've been working with communications, and our website had a new website. We have a projects page where, you know, whoever's out on those projects, go to Google Photo link that links to that page. You can go get update progress photos. Our job is to keep pushing that out because people, even I forget it's there, right? So we got to keep pushing, reminding people that information is there.